Welcome, everyone. My name is Michael Roytman. I'm the Chief Data Scientist at Kenna Securities. This talk is about issuing predictions for when a vulnerability will be exploited. But the takeaways from this talk are entirely different. Security is often a pendulum between prevention and detection and response, and there are good reasons for that. Technologies evolve differently in both of those domains, and I want to talk very specifically about the prevention side, what that means and why it's just now becoming possible in the real predictive sense and not in the FUD predictive sense. The takeaways are going to be threefold. First, and most important probably, is the machine learning when applied to a very specific question is very useful and is not so useful otherwise. The content expertise that everybody in this room has built is what's essential to asking the right questions and what's essential to making very simple machine learning models have huge business payoffs. The second takeaway is that a lot of our vulnerability management is stuck in the land of descriptive statistics. We often think about how we can address the backlog of security debt, and we often have that process break down when new vulnerabilities come out for which we don't have the data that we typically base decisions on. Thankfully, in today's day and age, that's less of a problem than it was before. Machine learning generally does one of two things. It either classifies existing data sets or it creates new data sets for us. And that's exactly what I'll show how to do. Most of the data used here is open source, and just about everybody should be able to recreate this in a GUI back home. And then the third takeaway is that prevention is impossible without prediction. And what prediction really means is not what our vulnerability scanners tell us. It's not what real-time threat detection tell us. Those are sources of data. To create predictive models, we actually have to model the environment instead of measuring it. So let's walk through those. The first half of the talk will be a lot of what is state-of-the-art today and what was state-of-the-art 10 years ago. And then we'll quickly get to the meat of the talk, which is using that data, let's build the predictive model, let's catch vulnerability management up to the world of weather forecasts, whether they're accurate or not, and how to judge that. So if prevention is prediction, then prediction needs to be done at scale. This is what Bohr means when he says prediction is very difficult, because you have to think about every possible situation. For us, if we tighten the question, if we tighten the scope of what it is we want to predict, then that becomes a tractable, feasible thing that we can solve with machine learning. Really, this talk is about data-driven analysis of security vulnerabilities. And there are only three types of data-driven analysis that one can do. The first is your retrospective analysis. That's what we've been doing in security for 20 years. We look at vulnerabilities, we describe them, we think about the events that have occurred in relation to those vulnerabilities, and then we come up with methods of categorizing them, whether that's a CVSS score, a severity ranking, some home-baked process that is more specific and better than that. Those are retrospective analysis based on what we've seen. Real-time processing or stream-based analysis is what we think about today when we think about vulnerability management evolving and integrating threat intelligence. Tons of vendors now look at, is this vulnerability being exploited? What is the rate of exploitation? Are there events that you're seeing in your enterprise, and so you should prioritize those? That's a step forward. That's a step towards the real-time processing. But both of those are still data collection, just with a different lag. Now, to move into the world of predictions, we're going to have to do some thinking. And moving into the world of prediction requires us to use that past data to generate new data. And it is impossible to do so for every bit of security information, but it is possible to create a very specific problem and address it using that approach. The problem that I want to address today is how to address risk from vulnerabilities. Really, when we assign severity rankings to vulnerabilities, to CVEs, to weakness enumerations, what we're saying is we don't have the capacity to address everything. So given our limited capacity, what is the optimal set of actions we can take? And we decide that by deciding what exposes our organizations to risk. There are many ways to do that. The first is the retrospective way of doing so. That is what we know as CVSS scores. We look at past vulnerabilities. We assign categorical data to them, such as what is the access complexity of this vulnerability? What is the authentication method? What's the confidentiality impact of this vulnerability? That is wildly useful information. But what that information is it is a point in time assessment of the software flaw itself, of the vulnerability. It has little to do with the risk that it poses and a lot to do with the impact portion of that risk. The real-time methods that we have today, I can only speak to the ones that I know. So this is the data set that I have at hand. I won't spend too much time in this talk describing it, but essentially it is data about events as they relate to vulnerabilities. And specifically, Kenna Security has about 350 customers. We're looking at about 1.4 billion live vulnerabilities. That's the data set that I use to assess all the claims that I'm making. If I make a claim about this is effective or this isn't effective, what I'm really saying is, across those 1.4 billion vulnerabilities, this strategy has this much impact. It can reduce risk by this much. The second data set here is successful events, or events that we think are likely to be successful, as they relate to each vulnerability. So about 120,000 vulnerabilities in the National Vulnerability Database. Of those, about 95,000 are vulnerabilities that are confirmed, and we have some information about them. Of those, maybe 20,000 are vulnerabilities that have proof of concept exploits or black hat exploit code. And of those, only about 2% are vulnerabilities for which we see successful exploitation events. And so the story of risk and vulnerabilities is the story of figuring out, before the attackers do, which vulnerabilities are likely to cause compromise. So let's take a look at what this data actually is. If you look at all of the vulnerabilities in, I think this is 2016, and you look at all of the vulnerabilities that were successfully exploited in 2016 or had events related to exploitation on them, then the probability that, you know, a year past the publication date, by virtue of what we're scoping this data to, that vulnerability is exploited is 100%. And the probability that it's exploited at the moment the vulnerability is released is non-zero. So that's the left-hand side and the right-hand side of the graph. What's interesting here is as you progress through days after release, the probability of exploitation goes up, and there's an inflection point at around the 40 to 60 day mark. And that gives you an art, not science benchmark of how fast attackers are at actually exploiting a vulnerability after that vulnerability is released. But what's way more interesting here is that each day before the 40, 60 day mark, there's still a non-zero probability of that exploitation occurring, which means that at day zero, there's still some chance you'll get exploited on that vulnerability. At day 10, that chance jumps up to about 25%. And so if your SLA for remediating a vulnerability is 30 days, that is probably backed up by the data. However, you still have a probability of exploitation there. So what we want to do is we want to shorten that time from vulnerability release to when you know which ones to target. What the data also tells us is that if we were to undertake a strategy of just remediating CVSS-10 vulnerabilities, then that is fairly effective at catching vulnerabilities that have successful exploitation. So this chart is interesting because it's looking at the intersection of what we know is exploited scaled to that 1.4 billion vulnerability data set. What we're saying here is, if I throw a dart at one of the CVSS-10 vulnerabilities that exists, and I remediate all of those vulnerabilities in that 1.4 billion data set, what's the probability that I've remediated vulnerabilities that do have successful exploitation events associated with them? And that number is about 11.5%. That's twice as good as random. If you just picked a random one, it'd be about 6%. But what's more interesting is that very simple facets of vulnerabilities, like is there an entry in exploit DB, is there an entry in Metasploit, or more poignantly, is there an entry in both a proof of concept code and a weaponized piece of code, gets that percentage up to 36%. And so this is the first part of this talk where I introduce the idea of capacity, work effort, as it relates to effectiveness. So think about that. In the CVSS-10 scenario, 28% of vulnerabilities are CVSS-10. You would have to remediate all of them to remediate 11.5% of the vulnerabilities that have successful exploitations. And that's a pretty good hit rate. 1 in 10 is an action that is actually reducing risk. In the exploit DB and Metasploit scenario, it's much less. It's about 15% of your vulnerabilities. And 1 in 3 of your actions is actually effective at remediating vulnerabilities. So that's a very simple facet. Models can get much more complex. But I want us to think about strategies that we're undertaking to vulnerability remediation in those terms. How much work do I have to do? How much risk am I reducing with that? And what is the effectiveness of each action that I'm taking? Am I wasting cycles on remediating vulnerabilities that will never be exploited? And then, of course, the question becomes, how do I know if something's going to be exploited before it actually does? So the answer to the old question, the question of how do you address security debt, is pretty well known, if not styled properly in my slides. If you have 10 million vulnerabilities and you want to be effective in addressing that backlog, we know that answer from the DBIR investigations reports, from published vulnerability data. We know that the answer is you fix the old, stable, weaponized vulnerabilities first, because attackers already know they're successful, they're scanning the internet, there's non-targeted attacks that are prevalent and effective at exploiting those. But that's not the whole question. Every day a new vulnerability is released. Today, MITRE will release about 20 new vulnerabilities, NVD will score about 15 of them. And I see this question in enterprises all the time, what do we do about that new vulnerability? The reason that people scramble and the reason that you can't give an answer to the CIO about what we're doing about this or that vulnerability is because there just isn't any data about it. The most that we know is maybe a description, and if we're lucky, the CVSS score. And so what we do is we have to predict what the data set for that vulnerability will look like. Predicting all of it is hard, so we're going to focus on a specific subset. And as the previous slides might have led you to believe, the specific subset that really matters is, will this vulnerability have an exploit or not? Will it have publicly available exploit code? And that's because a vulnerability with public exploit code is 7 times more likely to be one that will have successful exploitations associated with it than one that doesn't. It is the single biggest indicator of risk on a vulnerability, because obviously, if it's publicly available, the script kiddies can attack you with it, it's easy to automate, nobody has to expend effort on writing that exploit code. But what we're modeling in the predictive sense is specifically that effort. It's what incentive does an attacker have to write and publish exploit code on a particular vulnerability? And that's what this model will do. An aside about machine learning, it only does 2 things. It can either look at your data and tell you these are the groups, or this is additional meaning that you don't see from that data. That's unsupervised learning. That's if you don't know the outcome and you want to create some groups. And then there's supervised learning, which you do have data in the past for which you know the outcome, and then you want to predict something about it. You want to generate new data. So in our scenario, we have a lot of vulnerability data, about 120,000 vulnerabilities, and we have a category that is has exploit or doesn't have exploit. A very simple binary variable, but one that we know is very important to predict and to know ahead of time. So about 23% of those vulnerabilities do have exploits, and that is a classification supervised learning machine learning method because that label is discrete. If it was a numerical variable like how many attacks will we see on this vulnerability, that would be a regression-based supervised learning machine learning approach. And we could form the question in either way. We could say, what will the volume of exploitation on this vulnerability be? Or we could form it to say, this vulnerability will have an exploit or will be exploited. And the reason we choose to do the binary one, the simple classifier one, is because it is more likely to be accurate if the decision is easier to make. And we already know that it's indicative. So let's walk through that decision. What we're really doing is we're saying a new vulnerability is released today. I know some text-based information about it. I know which products it affects. I know maybe some CVSS vectors about it, maybe not. I know which references have written about it and which vendors seem to care about this thing. How do I determine whether that vulnerability is actually dangerous, whether it will actually have an exploit written for it? There's a naive approach to this, which I took many times, and I'll walk you through that. And then there are some learnings in taking the naive approach that both reveal some things about how attackers work and make the model better. So our output is qualitative, it's yes, no, and the prediction that we want to make is, will a vulnerability have an exploit for it? The way that I do it is with Amazon machine learning, so anybody should be able to recreate this for about $10 back home. And the reason I do that is because it's easily scalable and it's very cheap. This is a cool business aside, which is Amazon machine learning is made to make predictions about whether or not a customer of a transactional store like Target is likely to buy a particular item, which means they're issuing millions of predictions every hour or every day, and so they charge per prediction. But in the vulnerability space, there's only about 100,000 of them, so to predict every single vulnerability will cost you about $8 or $9, and that's a really good way to, you know, hack their value proposition. The data that we're using comes from the National Vulnerability Database and the Common Platform Enumerations. That tells us the products and vendors. All of that is publicly available in the National Vulnerability Database. And then the way that we generate the label for those vulnerabilities is by scraping a bunch of the internet. We look at the exploit database, Metasploit, D-squared Security provides which exploits they have in their Canvas framework, in their Elliott framework, which is based on Canvas. So we also know which exploits exist there. And then Contago published a really cool spreadsheet in 2016, I think, that documented all of the Black Hat exploit kits known to date and assigned the CVEs that those exploit kits used. And so we use that as a label as well. News sources are good at that, Recorded Future is good at that, IBM's iDefense is good at that. There's many commercial sources that will do this, But all of this is publicly available, so you could kind of walk with me and recreate it yourself. The model that we use uses a 70% training, 30% evaluation split, a standard L2 regularizer. Amazon lets you tweak how much compute you want to use, and they will allocate it cheaply. So we're using 1 gigabyte per model and training it 100 times to get the actual receiving operating characteristics for it. So a few caveats here. If I were to just randomly guess that every vulnerability will not have an exploit, my model would be 77% accurate, because 77% of vulnerabilities don't have exploits. And so to be good, you have to be better than 77% accurate. And in fact, maybe accuracy is not such a good measure, and here's why. Precision matters a lot more than recall here. That is, if I make a prediction, whether or not that prediction is correct is way more meaningful to your business than how many vulnerabilities I catch that have exploits in the future. And the reason is simple. This model doesn't exist in the abstract. It exists within the confines of a vulnerability management practice. And so what that means is that the data about those exploits coming out doesn't mean that your model is wrong. It means that you have a different process that tells you you should remediate things that have exploits. So if the model is good at predicting some things and effective at telling you what to fix that you otherwise wouldn't, that's valuable. But if the model isn't very accurate and making guesses about everything that are, you know, 60% accurate, 50% accurate, that's not very useful to you, because you have that backlog to address. And you know that that backlog is way more important than whatever it is we're predicting, because it's already stable and known. So we want to bias the model towards precision. We want to create one where if we tell somebody to fix something, it's effective. And that's not specific to this model. That's just the problem of vulnerability management. You don't want to overload the people actually remediating vulnerabilities, and you want to be precise with your recommendations. And the other caveat is that we're not modeling when this vulnerability will be exploited. That's future work for us. But in order to be accurate, in order to not constrain ourselves with, will this get exploited in 3 months or in a year, all we're doing right now is the most simple case, which is, will an exploit come out or not? Could be tomorrow, could be in 6 months. But what's cool is if you're rerunning the model every day, the hope is that your predictions are more effective daily as more data comes out. So let's try, and then let's think about why our attempts don't work. The most naive approach to this would be just to throw in what we get from NVD and then try to score them. So this is the CVSS based in temporal vectors, whether or not it's a remote code execution, the categorical data that CVSS is built off of, and then the publication date of the vulnerability. And once what you get here is a model that's 79% correct, which seems cool until you realize that the baseline is 77. It's not very useful, and it's very difficult to separate what is predicted yes and what is predicted no. The precision of this model is about 59%, and the recall, or the amount of vulnerabilities that we categorize, is about 30%. And so what we're doing here is we're building a model on 70% of the data from the start of time to 2018, and then we're grabbing 30% of it to see how the model performs on that. And the answer is not very well. So how do we assess whether it's performing well? What we want is we want separation between the vulnerabilities that the model labels as likely to be exploited and the ones where the model labels them as not so. So we want none of the shaded area to exist in the bottom. We want there to be a very clear cutoff decision point where everything to the right of that thing is a yes and everything to the left is a no. The yellow unshaded are ones where the model guessed yes and it was correct. The shaded red underneath that are ones where the model guessed yes and it was wrong, so those are all false positives. The shaded, the unshaded gray are ones where the model guessed no and it was correct, those are our true negatives, and so on. So red is our errors, we want to separate those errors, but you can see very clearly that there is no scenario in which you don't get errors here unless you make the cutoff very high in this example, which is not indicative of exploitation. To make it more simple, you want good separation, so when you pick a decision point that says model scored this 0.5, then everything to the right of it is a yes. But what that exposes is a trade-off that's inherent in all information retrieval. That is to say, for any one model, you can choose to be precise or you can choose to retrieve a whole bunch of documents. And this isn't a problem that's specific to security or vulnerability management, although it is one that I think is prevalent in security and people don't think about often. What we're really saying in security is all sorts of forms of the question, I have a thing, does this thing matter? That could be an event, that could be a piece of malware, that could be an indicator of compromise, or that could be a vulnerability, as in my case. And the models that we build They return a set of documents or a set of things that we think matter from a set of things which we don't know whether they matter or not. We can be precise there, which means we will return few and obviously miss a couple, or we can have high recall. We can have a lot of coverage, which would mean that we might catch everything that will eventually have an exploit, but in doing so, we'll also catch a whole bunch of the stuff that is false positives. And so for every model that we create, this is the next one we'll explore, there's a trade-off that we can make. We can be more precise or we can have more recall, and that's essentially sliding that decision cutoff point to an area where you retrieve very few as your model output and you're precise, or very many. The issue is, in a model that looks as crazy as this, there's no clear cutoff point. There's no way to make that decision. And so what changed from the previous model to this one is I added whether or not a patch exists for a vulnerability. I could click through to the next one, but I think this is the important part where we think about what this data means and why the models are performing in specific ways. What does patch existence mean to an attacker that is trying to craft an exploit for a vulnerability? Well, it means that likely there is a mitigation already available out there, and the payoff from writing that exploit is less than the payoff from writing an exploit for a vulnerability that doesn't have that patch. But that's not always the case, because there's some vulnerabilities which are grouped together within patches. So maybe you have 12 vulnerabilities that are part of an advisory for Adobe that's fixed by one particular patch, and there's no vulnerability in any of the other associated vulnerabilities there. So then if somebody's patched it, you can't attack it at all, and that's not a very good thing to pursue writing an exploit for. But if none of them have an exploit right now, maybe that's feasible. And so adding this data does help. It doesn't increase the accuracy, but it increases the precision of the model a bit, and it certainly increases the recall. But it's not clear to me that that is a variable that's indicative of whether or not an attacker will pursue it. The reality is people don't patch, and so you still want to write exploits for vulnerabilities that might have a patch out there. Let's add more data and think about it. And this is perhaps one of the more meaningful ones. If we add vendors and products, then we start to see some solid separation and the model starts performing better than guessing. There's many reasons for this. Vendors and products are an indication of prevalence. Pairs of vendors or products, for example, if a vulnerability affects 20 different vendors, you know it's a library vulnerability, so you know even more about its prevalence. But of course, we could try to measure prevalence on its own and see if we get an even better model. Before that, there's a whole bunch of data in vulnerability descriptions that if one was smart, they would spend time cleaning and creating new categoricals out of. But if one wanted to try the brute force approach, you would just create n-gram descriptions, which means take every description of every vulnerability and separate it into 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 word pairs, and then use that as a variable that might be predictive or not. And so this approach is very much brute force. It does have some positive effect on the model. We're up to 84% accuracy with a 70% precision at the cutoff. But the approach is pretty naive, because just as many of those categories that you create, like buffer overflow, certainly a meaningful thing that we should derive from vulnerability descriptions. For each one of those, there's also many that mean nothing, like somebody's name who submitted the vulnerability, or a typo that becomes a new variable that isn't very useful. And so the smarter approach is, of course, to figure out which of those variables that you've created are important, feed those back into the model. We can add actual prevalence too. And so there's two measures of prevalence that we add to our model. One is the number of vulnerabilities that exist live on systems, and this is where I'm cheating a bit, because you know we have the vulnerability scan data, but I'm not, because every enterprise that wants to try this back home also has vulnerability scan data where they can take a look and see if a vulnerability came out and we run a scan, how many of our systems are affected by it, and that's a pretty good guess of prevalence. Of course, the issue is that time zero you might not have a signature to scan it with, and so there's other things you could do, like take a look at the prevalence of vulnerabilities on the same products that vulnerability affects, and use that as a measure. Another interesting measure is the number of references for a vulnerability. And so that is how many people are writing about it. If you think about Heartbleed, the moment it came out, there were maybe 3 or 4 references, which is more than the average. But over time, that number of references grows. And it grew to hundreds for Heartbleed over time because it was in the media, because everybody started writing about it. But there are many vulnerabilities that don't have names, for which there also might be 10 or 20 different vendors writing about them, and that's probably indicative that writing an exploit for this thing is a big deal, or maybe the exploit is already written. And so now we arrive at the actual model that we use. What changes here is a couple of things. First is we hired Jay Jacobs and Wade Baker to take a look at all of our data and to figure out which features were actually important in those vulnerability descriptions using their own models, and then fed those back in here. So the n-gram descriptions creates about 200,000 different variables, none of which are very meaningful. But if you think about which of those have variable importance, you can identify 10 to 20 things that are in CVE descriptions that are as important as access complexity or confidentiality impact that we don't characterize as a variable today. Things like remote code execution, arbitrary code execution, maybe it mentions a header file, maybe it mentions a .c file, maybe it's a buffer overflow, maybe it's the man-in-the-middle attack. Those classifications are what the common weakness enumerations attempt to do to vulnerabilities, but that data is much spottier than the actual descriptions of vulnerabilities. Once you mine those out and create categoricals for each of those, the model improves. But there's another thing happening here, which is you have to think about what data you're feeding into it. So there's a lot of cheating that could happen if you build the model based on all vulnerabilities, or if you assess the model based on vulnerabilities that have exploits that are released before the vulnerability is publicly known. And so this is something interesting that also requires further exploration, but it's essentially the fact that there are two types of vulnerabilities in this world. There are those where they are disclosed because somebody found a flaw, and then attackers start to think, great, how can I use this? Is this prevalent? Should I write an exploit for it? And the exploit might come out 3 days later, it might come out 3 months later, it might come out 3 years later. We see that all the time too. There's another class, though, where we only know about the vulnerability because we've detected an exploit in the wild. And so issuing a prediction for such a thing isn't very meaningful because you're predicting a tautology, right? This vulnerability we know about because it has an exploit, I predict it has an exploit, is not a statement that's helpful to anyone. So slicing that out of the evaluation helps train better models as well. And then the interesting thing that we learned about attackers by doing this is that often this model will issue predictions about vulnerabilities that don't have an exploit yet, and you look at that exploit and you think, great, somebody should write this. This is obviously a great place to write an exploit and it would have high payoff. Except that one of the other vulnerabilities in that same patch advisory already has an exploit. And so there's no payoff to the attacker for writing that exploit because either they use the publicly available one on an unpatched box or the box is patched, so why did you write a second exploit? And so things like that are rules that we use to slice out our predictions, to not issue a prediction for something that already has an exploit written in its fixed advisory group or in its peers. And that gets us much better accuracy too. Lots of findings and lots of interesting things to learn about how attackers write exploits or why they're writing exploits, but take a look at where we arrived with this model. We're at 87% accuracy, not that accuracy matters a lot, but more importantly, we're at 78% precision, which means for every prediction that we issue, we are, you know, for every 5 predictions we issue, 4 are going to be correct predictions, and those exploits will eventually come out. And our recall is around 50%. And so what that means is that half of all vulnerabilities that will ever have an exploit are captured in this model under this threshold. I could stop the talk here and that would be fine, but what's more interesting is how are we going to use this data? And this is where we start to think about efficiency and coverage and how this integrates into a vulnerability management practice and not just the academician's answer to look a great machine learning model. The reality is that most organizations don't make decisions like we will fix everything that this model output is 0.6 or above. In fact, they scope it to their business units, they look at it in relation to other vulnerabilities that they have. And so what we offer is 3 cutoff points, 3 different types of thresholds for which you can make a decision based on your own risk tolerance. So I think of this as, and I actually put this in the wrong order. So the most likely scenario is one where we set the threshold really highly, so we issue only a small number of predictions. And that means that for every prediction we issue, we're pretty sure it's going to be correct. There's a 95% precision at this cutoff point, at everything that we score at 0.9 or above. But the problem with that is that we only capture 23% of the vulnerabilities that have exploits. That's fine. Fix those first, and then you want to have a relaxation of your risk tolerance, which is I fixed all the ones, I've remediated the vulnerabilities that we are very sure about having exploits come out. And so let's move on to the next stage, which is what we call highly likely, but that's essentially from 0.75 to 0.9. Vulnerabilities in that class have a precision of about, I think this is 88, but it's about at 90 in the model, and a recall of about 33% or 34% in this model, which means you'll capture more of them, but you'll be less sure that every decision you made is correct. And then you can walk it back even further and capture about 50% of them and be 80% sure that each decision you're making is correct. But this kind of cutting up of the model is also interesting by itself because it tells us something about what kinds of strategies are valuable and how to implement them. It is not sufficient to say yes, no as an output, even though that might be the right question to ask and that might be the thing that makes this machine learning model effective. It is more interesting to have a continuum of decisions along which you can slide and move from these are the things we're sure are a huge risk to these are the things we are less sure about, but we should remediate now that we've addressed those issues. This issue itself is not about predictions, but it is rather about prioritization itself. And I'll get back to that in a second, because the way that you use this model is to address or to predict exploitation, but the reality is you're using it to make decisions about what to remediate, and you already have a basis for those decisions. A quick aside is that in the future, we want to be able to predict not just whether or not something has an exploit, but whether or not that vulnerability or that exploit has been used in a successful compromise. And that's a more specific model with less data that will take more work, but that's future work here. It is possible that the process by which attackers exploit vulnerabilities varies by vendor. That's something to explore. Building a model just for Microsoft and obviously giving it to them to take a look at might be more precise than building a model across all vulnerabilities. Similarly, building one that only works on library vulnerabilities might be more precise because different parts of the descriptions might be more valuable. And adding more data. We're using vulnerability data or vulnerability descriptions from the National Vulnerability Database, but we all know that's not the end-all be-all of vulnerability data. There's other databases that have more precise data or better descriptions. There's commercially available descriptions, but there's also the advisories themselves, which write up both the remediation methods and the vulnerability itself, and that might contain clues as to whether or not an exploit is likely to be written. So the problem is that we want to derive risk from a vulnerability. And the solution, again, excuse my graphic design here, is this. You want to gather the data about the known attack paths, which is what we're all doing today in prioritizing vulnerabilities. You want to issue forecasts about those vulnerabilities where you don't have the data. And you know, this has a dual use, but both of the uses are positive, which is very rare in security. The first use is, a new vulnerability came out, should I fix this vulnerability? The answer is yes, great, go fix it. I am confident that that decision is correct, and here's my degree of confidence. But the second is, a new vulnerability came out, my red team is working on writing a POC for it. They haven't been able to do so for a week, and they're still burning cycles on it. Should I stop? Quantifying the fact that that is a vulnerability that's unlikely to have an exploit gives you a reason or a stopping point in expending effort as well. So that's the dual use of the model. The no's are also useful because the no's tell you where maybe you shouldn't be spending vulnerability assessment time. And they're useful because they're quantified and they're issued for every vulnerability so you can make comparative decisions. But then what's more important is that after those decisions are made, after new exploits are released, you can update your model by looking at whether or not they've been successful. If the model is wrong, let's find out why. Let's integrate that back into the model. Let's integrate that back into what we prioritized because we publicly know an exploit we should be fixing anyways, even if the model said that no exploit will come out. And so that feedback loop is where we start to enter into the world of actually predictive security, actually predictive vulnerability management, not predictions as descriptions of risk, but predictions as forecasts of risk. So the takeaways here are simple. When risk is rare, precision is difficult, prediction is difficult. And the more simple the question you ask, the more likely you are to be successful in having an accurate, useful answer to that question. Everybody here knows the right questions to ask. The machine learning tools are in GUIs on AWS now. So the question is, can you find one that's tight and specific, the answer to which is meaningful? For example, will this vulnerability have an exploit? And there are such use cases all around security, where if your goal is not too audacious, but it is impactful, you'll have success. And then the biggest takeaway is that when precision or prediction is difficult, you have to be smart about the trade-offs. Do you care about capturing every alert? What is your capacity? What is optimal for your capacity? How many predictions or how many recommendations of patches can your organization handle per week? So scope your models to that. That's not the takeaway. The real one is that anyone can machine learn. It's not a process that's complicated. The complicated process is the evaluation of the output. And that's a question of subject matter expertise and understanding how those algorithms work. By the way, the graphs that I use to explain how you make a cutoff decision or which portions of the graph you should look at aren't mine. They're included in AWS ML. They're things that every one of the GUIs that is doing machine learning for you will walk you through and explain to you as you're doing the thing. Okay. And so we now arrive at the more important part of this, which is that if we want to assess how good we are at predicting something, what we really want to do is compare it to baselines. The baseline of guessing no to every exploit isn't very meaningful to us because that's not what organizations actually use. Organizations typically say, let's fix all the criticals, or scope to our DMZ, let's fix CVSS 10 or above, or we work on Microsoft Patch Tuesday cycles and we address Microsoft and then we throw in three other vendors into there. So all of those strategies can be measured in terms of the precision and coverage, the efficiency and coverage of undertaking that strategy. The best way to do it is to look at all of the vulnerabilities that you would address in undertaking that strategy and to see whether or not they will have whatever target variable you're looking at, in this case, an exploit or an exploitation. For the predictive model, that's how you come up with a good one. That is the method by which you train your model and by which you make it better. But for your vulnerability management strategy, that is how you measure your own success. And the most interesting takeaway here isn't that this model performs better at predicting exploits than a strategy of CVSS 7 or above or just fixing everything on the bug track list. It's that, one, you are doing less work to be more effective. That means you're scoping your predictions tighter, you're more precise, and that's of course a consequence of biasing the model towards precision. But two, you have a continuum of choices. You don't have to say, let's just do CVSS 10 and above, let's fix these 200,000 vulnerabilities, or let's do CVSS 9 and above and fix these 400,000 vulnerabilities. You have a rank order of every vulnerability, and you have decision cutoff points that you set yourself based on your capacity and based on your risk tolerance. So the perfect world is one where you start with these 10 vulnerabilities are the ones that I'm most sure of as being risky, let's fix those. And then expand that to 20, expand that to 200, expand that to 200,000, instead of taking kind of lopsided swipes at it. And so that's what I mean by to prevent is to predict. If you really want to be preventative, you need to make sure that every decision is as effective as it can be, not in the totality of, you know, these are criticals, we should fix those, but on a case-by-case basis. And the best way to do that is to build predictive models that are granular enough to enable that kind of decision-making and to teach people why those models are more useful than the typical, less data-driven dogma that we might be using otherwise. So that's it. Thank you, everybody, for waking up at 8 a.m. I'm sure there are questions, and I'm happy to answer all of them. Yeah, so it's not a product, it's a feature within our regular product. It's something we use to make our prioritization better. This is an SVM that I'm presenting in these models. These little guys, where are they? And that's largely because that's what's available in AWS by default. You can change the classifiers, you can change the training parameters, but our work with Scientia, we've also done a random forest to figure out feature importance and then feed it back into the SVM. So essentially, doing it cheaply and doing it at scale in AWS is important for production constraints, but to figure out which features are important, you know, random forests are a much better model and a better way to look at conditional expectation plots or something of that nature.
Yeah, that was the first thing I was going to ask, is how you did your feature optimization, because you mentioned you did it. But it seems to me that, that was the hardest part. I mean, when you had the naive models that you showed earlier, you just kind of lumped all the features in and saw what happened. I mean, sure, SVMs are good for that, but you know, you didn't get super great results.
Yep.
How long did it take you, and sort of how much depth of understanding of the data sets did it take you to do the feature optimization that led to your sort of really good models later?
You're going to call me out on everything.
Sorry.
this model took about a year to get to the state where it is today. And there were two sets of expertise and two ways to assess the features that were meaningful in doing so. The first is our head of research is Jonathan Cran, who is a person who can write exploits. Mm-hmm. And when the model outputs something, he can assess whether or not it's bullshit. Mm-hmm. And that's very important in feeding back into the model and figuring out whether a feature addition has been impactful or not. And the second is Jay Jacobs, who is somewhere in this audience. There he is. concurrently as we were training this production model, he was running a random forest model where feature importance and feature selection is easier to understand. Mm-hmm. And then we would use that with the assumption that both models would benefit from the features. And before that, we did the naive approach of let's add this or take this away and see if the model is better, which is actually not that meaningful.
Yeah, that's hard to do well.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks.
I thought the cumulative probability of the of an attacker building an exploit for a vulnerability that was released was really interesting. And I was wondering if you also looked at the distribution between the initial announcement and any published code or published exploit, because, I mean, this is not an issue if you're rerunning the model every day, but if you don't want to be constantly changing data points in the event that an exploit does come out 3 years after, right? So I was wondering if maybe there's a similar like flattening going on with that, and in which case you could perhaps only add CVEs that were, you know, 2 months old, 40 days old, something like that.
We're publishing a report that will include that data about what the flatness of the curve looks like from announcement of vulnerability to publication of vulnerability. Those are actually different things, like the reservation versus the publication, to the publication of exploit code. In production, what we do is we just don't make predictions about vulnerabilities that do have exploits. And then the rest of the data gets updated. But you're also correct that if we wanted to put assign a probability to it or a time frame to the prediction, what we would have to do is continuously subset the data on which information did we know at which point. And the reason we didn't do that is we didn't have the data warehouse going backwards to do it, and we will in the future, and eventually you will see that model if RSA accepts my talk next year. We've got 1 minute left, but I'll post this deck, answer questions on Twitter, which is the best place to find anyone, or come up to me after or during the conference. Thanks, everyone.